Is your business struggling to stand out from the crowd online? At Webamax, we specialize in turning clicks into customers. From SEO and PPC to social media management and stunning web design, we've got you covered. Boost your online presence and drive real results. Ready to take your business to the next level? Visit webamax.com. That's webimax.com for a free digital analysis. Roll the web with webamax.com.
Upgrade your business tools with an American Express Business Platinum Card. Unlock over $1,000 per year in statement credits on select purchases in categories including tech, wireless, and recruiting. And so big expenses can deliver big benefits, you'll also earn 1.5 times membership rewards points on single eligible purchases of $5,000 or more. Terms and points cap apply. Learn more at americanexpress.com/business-platinum. Amex Business Platinum. Built for business by American Express.
Allstate wants to remind fans that mayhem is everywhere. Like when your fantasy league meets up at your house. Everything's great until the hot plate gets too hot for the tablecloth. Now your kitchen's up in smoke. And if you don't have the right home insurance coverage, the cost to fix this is anything but a fantasy. So switch to Allstate, save money, and get protected from mayhem like this. Not available in every state. Based on coverage selected, subject to terms, conditions, and availability. Savings vary.
This episode is brought to you by Essentia. A better you starts with better hydration. Essentia is on a mission to inspire people to do what matters most. Their proprietary ionization process transforms water from any source into ionized alkaline water, providing water that's 99.9% pure with a pH of 9.5 or higher. Essentia overachieving H2O, the number one ionized alkaline water. Shop now.
Anything to shake, that's what I'm at. My football team's got me drinking.
Back at it again with another shade of blue. An absolutely amazing weekend in soccerdom. We had Copa, we had Euros, we had full slates of NWSL and Major League Soccer. It was nonstop. I enjoyed almost every minute of it, short of the 90 for Sporting Kansas City.
We sucked.
But the U.S. men started the Copa with 3 points over Bolivia. Good start for them. KC Current washed away the Portland Thorns. Washed away, Thad. Big win for them. They're still undefeated at the top of the table. Got back on track. So we have a lot to talk about. The we in that sentence is we, the Kansas City Soccer Journal. My name is Cody Bradley. Thad Bell and Robert Russert are here. And we're joined again by Josh Wallace. Josh, thank you for joining us, man.
Thank you for having me. Really excited to be here and talk soccer, talk Sporting KC with you all.
Excited to talk Sporting Kansas City. Look at that. See, he's rarely on the show, and he's already bringing more energy than Thad Bell. More optimism, more life than Thad Bell ever brings me. Thank you, Josh. So I am going to start. There's a lot to talk about, but let's go ahead and talk about Sporting Kansas City. 4-0 shut out in Columbus last night. It's a very good team, but really ugly performance all around. Josh, I just have some stats here. I'm just going to verbally vomit these gross, sticky stats all into your lap, and you can just respond. I'm just going to leave them all there, and I just want to hear your thoughts about all of them. Okay, is that okay?
Yes.
1 win in the last 14 MLS matches. 28th out of 29 Major League Soccer teams. 1 clean sheet all season. The only team that has not done that twice yet. 4 goals in 3 straight matches they have conceded. Last night's shutout versus Columbus. 3 total shots.
We sucked.
0 shots on goal.
We sucked.
3 crosses all night. They crossed the ball 3 times. You don't even have to be doing good to cross the ball. 3 crosses all night. That's insane.
We sucked.
Passes. Columbus, 672 passes. Versus Sporting Kansas City's 277.
We sucked.
And finally, an XG of 0.3.
It was terrible to watch.
Josh, your thoughts?
Man, the game was really hard to watch for Sporting KC. I felt immediately watching that we didn't really get a hold of the midfield. I also, it wasn't really clear that all the players felt you know, strong there, felt you know, were comfortable in the 3-4-3, you know. I'm not at the practices, so I don't know how often they've practiced this formation, or if it's kind of been something that's in the work, but it didn't feel comfortable. And also, I didn't really feel like tactically, it made a whole lot of sense. If you play away in, you know, you're playing in Columbus, I just don't know that you want to play there for their formation. You know, they, especially the formation they've been playing all year long and been playing really, really well in it. I felt like we couldn't really exploit the wide areas, which is why we didn't get a ton of crosses in. And I actually felt like the normal three-man midfield with the wingers that we have, I feel like that would have played a lot better that would have played a lot better against Columbus. So it was really hard to watch, and it you know, aside from the off the ball mistakes, it just didn't feel like there was a ton of fight in that game. So I feel like this was probably the worst loss that we've had all year. I didn't see a ton of energy. It just kind of felt like a lot of players felt defeated out there. And that's what was really, really hard to watch.
You said they didn't look comfortable, and I think that's a result of we've reached the point of the season where they're just throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. And I mean, I know you just have to do that at this point. It seems like a crazy thing to do against Columbus in their house, against that good of a team, and Cucho, who will pounce on anything. But I think that's where that comes from. Did you feel that they were kind of uncomfortable, maybe out of sync? We didn't see the Vermees system. Like, that's the one thing that we could kind of hold on to, was that everyone knew their role and everyone knew their spot. But yes, I agree with Josh. It was a little out of sync last night, Thad.
Yeah, well, I would agree. I think there's a lot of factors to it, though. One is just the players that are hurt, and then the third game in 8 days or whatever the number was. Mm-hmm. So there's tired legs. There's guys who haven't played much, you know, like KP hasn't played much over the last, I don't know, 2 years, right? So there's just all those factors into it. And then once you give up a goal, they're going to feel just defeated, because they have not been able to overcome that sort of deficit like all year. I mean, was there one that they came back from behind? I don't know. If they do, they give up two more if they come, you know.
Right, right.
It's just, I think it's all those factors in there, and it just was sad. Just sad.
Robert, Cucho thrashed us last night.
Yeah, but let's go back to what you guys have been talking about. I don't think it has anything to do with comfort. Comfort is nice, okay? Change the formation, the theory was right. Muck up the middle and make Columbus play wide. But none of that works if you don't have invested defending. And if you look at the first goal, 31-40, we have one of the crew players pinched on the sideline. There are three guys around him, but nobody commits to actually tackling the ball or being aggressive in that moment. So what happens? They get out of that box in that we had them, and then seconds later, Cucho's scoring his first goal. So none of that matters if we don't have committed, invested defending, and we just didn't have that. How many times did Volder look like,
oh,
okay, it's going in the net, I'll let it go. Okay, I'm not going to hustle my ass off and head the ball out or sacrifice my body. I'm just going to let it go.
Committed defending, Robert, that third goal. Have all of you seen the replay of chaos of the third goal? The whole back line, Fontas, Rosero, everybody was just standing around, gave up entirely on the play, and a second effort put the ball in the net. Truly embarrassing. Josh, have you seen this replay? Like, the question has been, Thad, we've talked about it a lot, of there's no way this team has even come close to quitting or giving up on the manager or anything like that. But Josh, that play looks absolutely horrible. It's embarrassing.
It does. And if I remember correctly, this was the play where they got played through the midfield, right? They got played through the midfield.
Sliced. Sliced through.
Yeah. Sliced through the midfield. And Ramirez, eventually the ball gets to Ramirez and he scores. And so I feel like in years past, right? If that happens in Sporting KC, someone's going to take a foul. Someone's going to take a yellow and, you know, stop the play, right? Like, you're not going to let someone just go all the way, get through the midfield that way.
Roger broke that pass up in the midfield long ago, got a red card for it, and they never scored. That's how that worked.
Yeah, and we just haven't seen that. And then even more than that, it's just the off-ball defending. You know, Robert mentioned it, right? On the when you even just look at the first goal, KP gets hurt. Kyrie comes right in and immediately overplays the winger. I think Arsenev is his name, who was, I mean, getting in behind KP and Shelton.
Oh, he had his hands full.
All night long. And, I mean, he plays across goal, like, immediately, within seconds. Like, you know, so, and that was kind of really the theme. If they weren't doing it from the wing, they were doing it right from the midfield. And it seemed like they, you know, that just the off-ball defending is all year long has just been tragic, right? Like, if the ball goes behind us, there's not a rush to go back and get numbers behind the ball, right? You see Fontas walk. I mean, Lord Sam on the call of the game mentioned it several times, you know, of people walking or jogging, right? Like, there wasn't like a sense of urgency. And I think that's what's really frustrating. There's not really a sense of urgency there.
And Josh, that's what this team always was. That's what we thought any Peter Vermees coach team always would be. And they've somehow lost that. Thad, I want to hear your thoughts on the highlight of the defense just quitting on that play. We've spent time saying these guys haven't given up. They're going out there. They're fighting. You could see some of that in the RSL game. Tommy was a post away from tying that game. They fought back. They showed something. But, Thad, what was this? What happened?
Man, how can I explain this? Well, I can't explain it because, I mean, I tried harder in media games and I'm a fat old guy. So I don't want to say they've given up, but man, I'm starting to worry they have. Because that's always been the worry is if the players give up on the coach, if coach has lost the locker room, that's when it's done. Because you can't come back from that in season usually. And they're still, 3 weeks away from being able to, over almost a month away from being able to add a player. So there's not even like fresh blood coming in the next 4 weeks, 3.5 weeks.
Yeah, Thad, I don't know if it's given up. It might be, guys. Let's be honest here.
Yeah.
It might be realizing we're just not good enough.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, the movement of Cucho, David mentioned it in the chat here. Yeah, he's got elite movement, and he's a clever player. Volder was clueless trying to mark this guy. And, you know, just might look at each other and say, we're just not good enough, guys.
Yeah.
And if we go down a goal, heads are down, here we go again.
Yeah, Robert, I saw the same thing. The specific way their heads were hanging just looked like, not like I give up, but it's just we're not good. They're so much better than us. Cucho is better than us. I can't stop that guy. Caden Pierre can't stop that guy on the wing. Like, what are we supposed to do? They're already defeated
right. When the game starts, essentially.
Yeah. And, I mean, there's a fine line. That pretty much is the same thing as giving up. But, no, I know exactly what you meant when you said that, Robert. I got that same impression as well. But here we stand, fellas. Vermees is here to stay. The question from this point out is just, what are we hoping for this season, Thad? What can we hope for the rest of the season? You've talked about maybe there are players coming in, but what can we take out of this? Are we just at the point where all we can ever hope for is the twice a year we play our rival and we can hopefully beat them and have something?
You have to hope that they can get it together because I don't completely buy they're just not good enough. They're good enough to compete. They may not be good enough to be top of the table or upper table. They're good enough to compete. It's essentially the same guys who were able to compete the second half of last season, right? It's essentially the same guys minus Kenda. And you, in theory, have some healthier people, but it's got to be mental because, I mean, the skill was there. I mean, I know they're a year older and all that stuff, but I don't know. I'm at a loss for what I can predict or at this point, because you keep coming out like, hey, maybe they're going to like get a result and they'll get a little momentum. They got a result like three games ago and they're right back to where they were, if not worse.
Josh, so this is it, man. We saw the article. Ownership has backed him. He's going to stay here. He's got three transfer windows to rebuild. Where do you stand with all this? Who's at the center of your frustration? Is it even Vermees at this point, or is it higher than that?
It's difficult because, yes, I do give Peter, you know, Vermees a lot of, he shoulders a lot of that blame, right? I think that there are players that we could have moved on from or a lot earlier, made some of these changes, you know, a lot earlier, added more players in earlier windows. But I also understand, right, like, I think Remy Voltaire is a huge loss, right? Like, what he does off the ball is huge. So, like, I won't completely, you know, I mean, Peter Vermees can't control injuries, right? Like, so injuries do play a small part in it, but it seems like just throughout the season that I think some of the decisions tactically, you know, might have not supported winning some of these games. I think, you know, some of it is on the players, right? Like, you know, just not being able to manage games when we were early in the season. I'm with that in that I do think this team is good enough to compete. I just feel like right now maybe they don't believe that they're good enough to compete because of what's constantly happening every game. I mean, they get a goal down and it's difficult. But you know, if I'm Vermees is going to get a chance to rebuild this roster. And I think for the most part, a lot of these players would not be coming back. If I was rebuilding it, and I mean, you're really kind of planning for the future at this point, I think. I think, you know, try to get the amount of points that you can, and maybe make a run in the U.S. Open Cup, right? Because we're still in that. But outside of that, you're really at this point, you're probably planning for the future.
I think you're trying to avoid the wooden spoon, beating St. Louis, and yes, giving us maybe another win in the Open Cup. Robert, where do you stand with this? What can we get out of this season? How are you just playing the kids? What are you doing with the rest of this year?
You know, that's it's not an easy answer. I want to back up a little bit, though. We're not good enough. A lot of teams build through their – okay, a lot of teams. Some of the more successful teams in this league, Philadelphia Union, even though they've kind of fallen down, other teams will build from their academy. And our academy, you know, Jake Davis, sure. Afrifa's looking good. Let's give that credit. But we really haven't gotten any players that are really of a consistent quality to come out of our academy in recent memory, besides Davis, perhaps. So we don't have that to fall back on, whereas other clubs, I think many other clubs do, not all. We're not spending the money that other clubs are. And apparently we're not good enough at identifying talent of the players that we do bring in. And I also think Peter is too much in love with the reclamation projects, like a Memo Rodriguez, and that's a laundry list right there, guys. So I just think the whole roster build has just not been good enough. And I see less and less the sense of letting Peter rebuild this roster, because we were here last year, guys. 2020 was a sham of a first place in the conference. Sorry. And then our ouster in the playoffs for years and years quickly, because again, we didn't have the talent level that other teams do. I'm just tired of it.
I think a lot of people are tired of it, Robert. I want to go back and kind of respond. I think the spending is not enough at this point. And Peter, I think, has done a really good job of making the most of the money that he has. Because that's one reason you see DPs like Shalloway, Demania, and some of the guys in the past, is you use the DP spot to pay them big, and then you drop the salary back down for the next cycle, and they get their money, and you can manipulate that around a little bit. So I think he's using that to make the most of the money, and like the allocation money that they've gotten from sales in the past or the normal allocation money process. I think he's done a really good job of that. But the problem is you need to find some guys that you're going to spend that money on. You spent money on Pulido. He has showed when he was on that he was really good. But the problem is
Trader Pete.
You know, he's been down this year. He was he's been down since he signed the contract. I don't want to totally like, oh yeah, he got his money and he doesn't care anymore, because honestly, I don't know that that's true. I don't really want to think that's true. But the U22 spots, I've talked to people, and there's a dollar value that for a U22 to be likely to be successful in this league. And I don't want to say what it was because I don't remember exactly, but there's a dollar amount where U22 is almost always going to be successful and you can sell them on. And there's a dollar amount when you're under that, they're not as likely to be successful. And all three of Sporting's DPs add up to less than what it takes for one to be successful. So, I mean, we could get still Logan and Dembe be a successful. Who knows, Volader, or I'm kind of giving up on Janice at this point, but at least maybe one of them could be. So that would be a great success in the fact that they paid less for him than what it takes normally to be successful. But if you give them the money to make three of those purchases or four under the new rules that are coming, just you could be a selling team, and we're not. And yes, I think there's a lot of issues, like you said, like the academy hasn't been as good as we would like it to be. There's a lot of teams out there that don't build through the academy because they go and spend, so they don't care. So there's probably, I don't know, maybe 50-50 of teams that really work on their academy to make money off of it.
Well, we're not doing either. We're not spending or doing the academy at the moment.
I know. I'm agreeing. I think they made good moves to change stuff in the academy, but that also takes some time. And, you know, I know it's pissed off some people locally when we say that Kansas City doesn't have as much talent in it as some places like L.A. or Texas or whatever. Still freaking true, whether it pisses them off or not. You have talent, you just don't have as much of it to choose from. And you have, the more talent you have to choose from, the more likely guys will develop and get up there. Again, changes to the academy rules where you have a limited, you can't poach from as many before, you can poach more now from than you could before. I'm sorry, I was stumbling over all that. But because they can only protect so many in their homegrown areas. And so now maybe we can get more of them from Texas or Southern California. But right now we're harming ourselves in doing that because we're not doing as well as we should.
Well, I think what you were talking about earlier, Thad, was Trader Pete. It feels like so long ago. Don't you remember, like, he used to have all of those moves. Daniel Shalloway, just a Hungarian guy as a homegrown for some reason because he trained with the team for like 2 weeks or something like that. He used to be able to do that. We used to get more out of the draft than other teams. But I think the other side of that that maybe you missed about him being so good at spending money is you're forgetting about Shelton and Fontas and even Redoya, if you want to add him into this. And that's not even including Pulido, who injuries was a lot of that, but still, even that's another one. So I don't know. I understand the point. It just, Robert, the Trader Pete stuff just feels like so long ago.
Yeah. And another thought that I was thinking of is our roster is like high risk, you could term it. Here's what I mean. Alan Pulido has to hit. Remy Voltaire can't get injured, you know, because him and Redoya work so well together. You don't have anybody to plug in for Remy Voltaire. Rosero has to play excellent all the time. And you could even see now, guys, that he's kind of lost interest and he's just not the player he used to be. And then, you know, Fontas has to... Let's not even go there. So we have a high-risk roster in that way that if these guys, certain guys, don't hit, we really drop down a bit when we go to those backup guys and we have to sacrifice.
Top heavy, David in the chat says here. And yes, we are. Top heavy, and the top is not doing anything.
Yeah.
That was Josh, but yeah.
Oh, Josh. Yeah,
no,
sorry.
I was just going to say, I wonder, you know, Thad and Robert, what you think about, you see a lot of other teams who at least make sort of changes or adjustments, right? Like in in the trade market within the league in MLS. And it feels like Peter has not really attempted to do that or really sought that out as an option. And that's whether it's trading for players, trading for more money, trading for even, I know this, some people might not like this, but like trading for even being able to get a higher pick in the MLS draft, because I will say there have been a few recently, top picks that are really, hit. So like those are also ways to get, players that could at least potentially have a little bit higher quality. Why don't we take more advantage of even trading within the league, getting players within the league that could improve the roster?
Well, they brought in Memo, and Memo's like maybe been the best addition. Memo was like our biggest addition of the offseason. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but he was a free agent.
Yeah.
So trades within the league, though, right? I think they've made some trades in the past. That was kind of back in the Trader Pete days when everything was mostly following his way. But right now, what do you have to trade? Because it's like that always like a perfect trade between teams, like thinking of baseball or basketball or something like that is when one team needs this and the other team needs that. And they make the trade and everybody's happy, right? Who are we going to send? Does anybody want Fontas right now? Sorry. Does anybody want Rosero? No. Does anybody want Pulido? The most anybody probably wants is Vargas or Frifa, and they're not going to bring you that much value. Tamilia to do stops and penalties. Nobody's going to trade you a lot for, approaching 40 goalkeeper.
Well, don't forget they tried and targeted Kellen Acosta, and I think that would have been a trade of some sort within the league. Or was he a free agent?
He was a free agent.
Oh, okay.
He was a free agent.
Okay.
And he was a guy who my understanding is was really, really close, but somehow a deal was made with Chicago that may have not been totally by how Kansas City's ethics would have went, their standards of how they would do deals.
Mm-hmm.
Robert, you were talking about just being tired of it earlier. And someone mentioned about selling on. And I feel like this team has had players that we could have sold on that other teams wanted. Dom Dwyer was like the last one. Robert, you mentioned a few of them, but I mean, even Busio. Busio was one I don't feel like we didn't get what we should have out of him. And then, what was the kid? The kid from Lee Summit, the defender, three-name kid.
Eric Palmer Brown.
EPB right. Left us. We got absolutely nothing for EPB. Robert, it just
okay.
It all that feels so, like so long.
I can
ago.
Argue with a lot of those though, Cody, because like Eric Palmer Brown, they tried to sell him. They sent him on loan. That team didn't have the money to buy him, and it's one of those that everybody points to. But really, the situation just turned out not to work very well, and he got to a point where he could leave on a free. So nobody's going to buy him.
But still, at some point, someone messed up and made a decision. They should have like it's hindsight's 20/20. Yes, but I'm. That's what we're talking about. Like, bottom line here, that a lot of players have left. Robert, you mentioned Ilya and Kinda and Beisler. Like, what the heck? We got to get something out of some of these guys if we're not going to be developing players, if we're not going to be spending. You got to get something out of these.
You're not going to get anything for any of those guys.
That's why I said kind of special cases with them. I get it, but
Yes, Beisler seems like a waste. Always an excuse. You should have signed EPB a year earlier if you wanted to keep him. Or there's any number of things.
He was under contract from when he was a youth player. Okay. He was under contract. They had him, but it got to a point where you can't send them before they're a certain age unless they have a passport, right? So you can't do certain things when they're at a certain age.
There was a window of time they could have sold him for money, and they didn't.
And they sent him on loan, shopping him. And that deal fell through. So when he came back, he was already in the window where he could leave on a free in 6 months.
I know. Okay. That is one. We've talked about that over the years. Yes. That one's
I'm just pointing
wrong.
Out, if you bring it up, you can't use that one as a reason if it's not accurate. Use ones that are accurate.
We listed off a whole bunch of other ones.
Okay. Which ones?
I tried to give them for Robert.
Beisler was washed before he left here.
Ilya.
Ilya. That's they could have signed him. He was they didn't get any value for because he was out of contract. They decided not to keep him because he was going to need more money than they were willing to spend on that spot at that time.
Just saying,
it's not a you lost him on a free. It's they decided not to sign him for the amount of money he wanted.
Okay.
Well, and no matter, the point remains that we have not.
There it is.
Gotten value out of players that we maybe could have. In a roster just isn't good.
I don't think there's anybody they could have got value for, though. That's the problem. That's more of a problem is that instead of saying they didn't get value for players they could have, is that they didn't have players they could get value for.
Exactly.
That's that's all the same problem. That all of that falls in here together.
But it's two different problems. Have the players that you can get value for, and then you can blame them for not getting value for them.
Isn't there a piece I feel like that might be missing from this is development, right? Like, you know, for you to for a player to be valuable, right? Like, you need them to perform and at least attempt to maximize some of their talent. For them to maximize some of their talent, there has to be some level of development. Now, I know there's often the back and forth between how much of that is on the player, how much of that is on the coach and the coaching staff, but it does not feel like we've done really, really well with developing players, you know, especially young talent over the, I mean, we've mostly gotten proven talent and they've turned out to be good. But when's the last time we really developed a player through the academy or even someone that we bought that's younger that has grown throughout the years? I feel like we don't do a lot of that.
Daniel Shallowy. Oh, wait. He stopped scoring too.
So, okay, guys. if you're watching these games and you're paying attention to the way the league works and all these things, and you're the owner of the team, how can you sit on your hands and do nothing? And say that, oh, we've got three windows to rebuild this team. Well, isn't that also the perfect time to make a regime change so they have a perfect time to do that too?
Thad, David in the chat has one last punch for you on that discussion. This one hurt too. I remember, and it's one more chance for you to give all these excuses and it doesn't affect the bottom line.
It's
and all
not excuses when it's facts.
Latif Blessing.
Facts are what you need when you analyze problems, okay? If you just keep throwing things out that are not true, you can just say, oh, everything is terrible. Everybody screwed up. You need facts. What is the problem? And then you can fix them. If all you say is, oh, they fucked up, it doesn't help.
Latif Blessing.
Yeah. Latif Blessing.
Okay, we got one. Good job, David, in the chat. Great, great contribution. We're going to go to break. We'll be right back.
Start your electric journey right here, right now. With a Volvo XC90 Recharge, our plug-in hybrid SUV with extended range. For more everyday electric journeys on a single charge, with a hybrid option for longer adventures, contact your local retailer to book a test drive or design your own vehicle at volvocars.com/US. The Volvo XC90 Recharge Plug-in Hybrid, the electric car with a backup plan.
All aboard! Welcome to the Friskies Express. Please keep all paws and tails inside the train. To the right, you'll see Crunch Canyon. To your left is Filet Falls. Now you're passing Party Mix Peak. Today's delicioso tour is almost over. But don't worry. With Friskies, there's always more to explore. Check out Friskies.com to explore more.
All right. Very quick break. We're back. Last week, we talked about potential for an incoming Socceroo, Patrick Yazbek. That looks like he is headed to Nashville now. Thad, that's not much of a loss, is it?
He was never coming here anyway. The rumors were false.
Original reporting there. Thank you for that. Any follow up there?
Okay, end of segment two.
No,
I'm kidding.
No, I mean, I kind of liked him, but I, from what I have gathered, was when we were first heard that rumor, everybody's like, nope, we don't even know. Like, we don't know anything about this. We don't know him. And it wasn't like the, well, we might have looked at him or something like that. It was like, no, we were never talked to the guy.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to get out of you there. You're supposed to say, my sources within the team confirmed that it was false rumors. They have not been in discussion with him.
I've also been told, and I could not find this, so that I'm not sure, but his agent even said that he was never going to Kansas City, that they were always in talks with Nashville. I couldn't find that like on Twitter or anything, so don't know about that one. But I think somebody like, oh, he's talking to somebody and in the Midwest or something, and they went, oh, yeah, okay. Kansas City really needs players.
Yeah. I think he also didn't really fit the profile of what even Peter Vermes said he was looking for, which is an attacking midfielder. I mean, I will say his game, you know, seeing some of his games, it definitely matches what you would want in a Sporting KC player, but not the one that at least we've said that we're looking for. So it wouldn't have, even if that was the case, even if he was interested in coming, I don't know that it was the right time and need for a player of his style anyways.
Well, Josh, you just recently gave us a list of some players that they should be going for. Thank you for writing that article. Very good. Who's your favorite? Why did you pick these three guys, or who was your favorite among them? Who's the best fit?
Yeah. So I guess I'll start with why I picked the three. So I tried to pick players that were going to be out of contract, that were already at least leagues that at or had some experience in leagues that we've pulled from in the past. And then also I kind of went by, you know, what Vermes said he was looking for, which was an attacking midfielder. I'll be honest, the player I really, really liked the most was the one I really started off with the article, Max Meyer. I assume that's how you pronounce his name, Max Meyer. He has a lot of experience in the Bundesliga. He was a German international. His game fits. He's played in a three-man midfield, I think, pretty much his whole career, and he's rarely, if ever, injured. I think his game really fits the type of attacking midfielder you want in Sporting KC's system even more than anything, because he'll break lines with the pass, he'll break lines with through dribbling as well. I also think about, you know, the connection within the midfield. You have Eric Tommy, who's played in the Bundesliga, who speaks German. Mm-hmm. Max Meyer. I mean, there could be a great connection with that. And also, he didn't make a whole ton of money. He was playing in – he's been playing in the I think it's the Swiss league. Mm. And he's not making a ton of money in that league. So now I know – I always understand, right, like a player has to be interested in coming to MLS, and even more specifically to Sporting Kansas City if they do come to the MLS, right? So that's a part of it as well. But a player like Meyer, I mean, he could be really good. He led the, I believe he led the league in created chances, you know, the Swiss league, which is not a huge league, but he still led them in created chances, which is with like 66. And I think right now he makes about what Kyrie Shelton makes. So, you know, he's played in a position in like a very possession offense, right, where they have the ball, they're going to move the ball. So he's probably my top choice out of the three. Although I think the other ones are, you know, younger and probably even fit, you know, the profile of a Sporting KC player even better.
Well, I liked all of the qualifications and the areas you were using to pick them from, but it looks like the number one rule you had was they had to have an awesome name, which we're aligned on that. Great names on this list. Max Meyer, I'm going to say Zadas, maybe Jadas, I don't know, just a single name guy, starts with an X, great name. And then the third one here is Jose Pozo. I mean, come on. It's like you made this list for me. Great names all around.
They're top three names for sure. Yeah. But yeah, no, those three are really, really good. I think Pozo and Zadis are also very, very talented. Still young. And I also wanted to get players that I felt like were in their prime. You know, I do think that we need to get younger, but you also we also need to get more talented, you know? So I feel like at least finding someone in their prime for as an playing an attacking role that that we can grab, I thought made sense. I also throw in another player that is coming out of contract who plays in the championship. And I think the championship, English championship, is, I think a lot of people would say is probably the most similar league to the MLS. Chris Willick. He has a brother that plays in the English Premier League, but Willick plays for, I can't remember. I think it's not Middlesbrough. I can't remember who he plays for.
Love a gritty guy from the championship. So I like where this is going.
Yeah. He plays winger, but also can play attacking midfielder. And I think he is he was really, really, really talented in the league. I would liken him very similar to like a right-footed Johnny Russell, but he's very aggressive, you know, very like direct. That's a player that's coming out of contract that I feel like Sporting KC could easily, you know, grab if he's interested in coming to Major League Soccer and more specifically to Kansas City.
That he found an efficient German midfielder the same price as Kyrie Shelton. We gotta put this in front of friend of the show, Jake. We gotta get in front of Jacob Peterson. Send these three lists. Have we done that yet? Is Jacob Peterson aware of these three targets for Sporting KC?
So when this pod is posted, I will give about 12 hours for Jake to text me. I'm not saying he will. I'm just saying I'll give him about 12 hours, and then if he doesn't, then I will send that to him.
Okay. Well, Josh, yeah, that's great work there, man. It's honestly an unfathomable task to me to just look at any and every player around the world in every league and try to identify some targets. So very well done with that article.
Thanks. It was really, really exciting work, actually.
All right, we're going to take one more break and then come back and talk about the rest of soccerdom over the weekend. We'll be right back.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. With over 122 million parts, you can make sure your number one ride or die stays running smoothly. Brake kits, LED headlights, bumpers, whatever your baby needs, eBay Motors has it. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, it's guaranteed to fit your ride the first time, every time. Plus, at these prices, you're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only, exclusions apply.
Ah, yes, the magnificent Trolley Sour Bright Crawler, also known as Trollicus Brightolus. The worm's captivating neon color makes it an easy, gummy prey.
Trolley!
It's a surprisingly sour, invitingly chewy, staggeringly snackable species unlike anything else found on this planet.
Eat me!
Delicious. Visit trolley.com to shop now.
Trolley, eat me!
All right, Euros are in full swing. Robert, own goal is the leading scorer of the Euros right now. How is that possible?
They need Cody Bradley. That's the problem.
Damn straight they do. Damn straight. No, it was
it's because these teams are so good. They're playing all these balls in the box, and you know that's on the list of possibilities. We score a beautiful header. We do this. And then, you know, somewhat near the bottom is it goes off one of their players and goes in. They all count the same, right?
That's right. Put it in dangerous spots. I also saw another stat that said they went 50 games in between in the Euro without a 0-0 draw. So suck on that, soccer haters. Scoring happens in this sport. Also, I saw a joke stat that said the second leading scorer after own goals in the tournament are the three goals that were called back for oh my God, what's his name? Lukaku in Belgium. He's had like four goals or three goals called back already or something like that. But earlier tonight, Copa kicked off for the U.S. men's national team. Josh, did you watch the 2-0 win for the Yanks over Bolivia?
I watched most of the highlights. I didn't catch the game in full. But to be honest, it's kind of what I expected. Bolivia is, you know, not a highly ranked soccer nation. No disrespect to them, you know, but the U.S. men's national team is of a higher quality. This is what you would expect from them. I thought it was a really great showing. I'm glad that Balogun scored.
Yes.
There was a lot of talk about, you know, whether or not either Sargent, Haji Wright, or Ricardo Pepi should be in the lineup over him. And he showed his talent, and you know, he got on the score sheet, which is what you expect from the number nine.
He did get a goal. I don't think he played that great the rest of the game, but he did get his goal. Pepi came in and did the same thing. Pepi missed a sitter, missed a follow-up. That one, I hope that doesn't get stuck in his head there for the rest of this tournament. We would like to see him get over that. But Thad, 2-0 versus Bolivia. They looked good. A lot more chances to score. Probably wanted more goals over a team like Bolivia, but 2-0 is a good way to start the tournament.
Yeah, it probably should have been 3-4-0, yeah. Just with as many chances they had, and you know, still missing quite a few of them. Man, I don't know how Pepi did not score on a couple of those.
Oh my God! Yeah.
Just, you know, there was a keeper that was not a tree making some stops.
Yeah.
But, you know, I
he kicked it right at him. So a tree would have made that double save, but I'd taken.
No, he taken. Got the keeper got his hand out on that one. So
yes, like
he definitely
branch.
Had to move.
A branch.
He had to move, man. It wasn't just like sitting there. But I was looking at the teams and stuff, and I was kind of amazed. The U.S. is like the third highest ranked team in the Copa America.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll take that.
We're 11th. Argentina is first. Brazil is fourth. We're at 11th. Colombia, 12th. Uruguay at 14th.
What are these stats that Brazil is behind us? What have they done that was so bad that, I mean, I guess.
No, Brazil is above us.
Oh, okay.
But they're the Argentina, Brazil, and then the U.S.
Well, that's kind of the thing. We talked about that last week. The U.S. has been taking care of all of the things we can in CONCACAF. We're winning all of that stuff. We've seemingly passed Mexico and all of that. They take care of that. But it's anything outside of CONCACAF that under Greg Berhalter that they've struggled. So I guess that ranking kind of makes sense. They've failed in these friendlies they've lined up against other European teams and stuff like that. But the actual competitions they're playing, Gold Cups, they were winning all of that. So I guess that actually does make sense to me.
Well, hey, Bolivia's outside of CONCACAF, so there you go. But anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we started off well, and, you know, just like the commentator said, I think we took our foot off the gas. We're going to have to be more explosive, obviously more lethal against other teams. But one thing I'm pissed off about, one thing that I'm worried about, anybody worried about Turner in goal? Because in the few little shots he had, he spilled one, didn't. It was awkward. His distribution out of the back was questionable at times. So I'm a little worried about Turner.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Turner got into that role very quickly through some just kind of magic and heroics that he was finding. And it was there, and he was, and I loved having him back there. But with club and country, yeah, there's just been some shaky moments, I would say. Josh, are you with us on that?
Yeah, I completely agree. And it's and not even just this game, but other games, he looks like a keeper that's not playing a whole lot, right? That's
right.
Not sharp. But right. But yep. Even more so, he is not the type of keeper that that works within the system Berhalter is trying to play, right? Like he more so wants someone who's going to be able to play with their feet. And that's not what Turner does well at all. That's not what he does well at all. I mean, he is kind of really an out and out shot stopper.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, this. I think Turner can get away with it in games like this, but when you come up against the, you know, the Brazils in Copa America, not in a friendly, and the Colombias, like those the. those teams punish you, and we've already seen how they do that. So
in Uruguay next week at Arrowhead.
Yeah.
So here's what pissed me off, guys. I was in Vegas Wednesday through Saturday, and I sort of get it, but it still pissed me off. Advertisements all over the downtown strip, feature a Mexican player, a Brazilian player, and of course, Messi. I'm like, where is the American player? What's going on here? Come on, this is America.
Okay, Robert. I have a bone to pick with you right now, man. Really a huge one, because my understanding is you've given up rooting for Sporting Kansas City and now follow Inter Miami, because you're wearing a pink Messi shirt on social media.
Number one,
it wasn't pink. So get that right. Number
there was
two,
pink on it. There was pink on it.
It's a Messi jersey, is what it is. It's not an Inter Miami jersey. It's just a Messi thing.
What team logo was on it?
It's my supporting of the greatest player of all time. That's all.
There was like a flamingo on there, right? Inter Miami. Yes. You could have gotten.
Would you prefer I have an Argentina jersey? Is that what you prefer?
I would have probably not been as upset by that, or Barcelona. I mean, you could have got old Barcelona one, man.
Okay.
Sorry.
Right.
So
well,
I'm
not
I'll
MLS.
Just,
I'll just ask you for the $180 for the Argentina jersey.
I missed that. So you went to go watch Messi?
No. I was just in Vegas, and one day I was there. I wore my Messi jersey. So
Thad was internet sleuthing you pretty hard.
Actually, I think I have to admit somebody else called you out for it, and I went, I gotta remember.
Jimmy
this
Mack for, did, yeah.
I gotta remember this for the pod, because I was gonna definitely give you shit for it.
One thing when we were talking about Matt Turner there, it just made me realize we didn't talk about Pulse Camp for Sporting Kansas City. There, I think, I thought it was maybe an odd choice. Melia had been playing really well. He kept Sporting in some of the last two games, actually, I think. So I think that it was an odd choice. But like I said, I think they are just throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. And Thad, are they maybe not sold on if Pulse Camp is the guy for the future? So maybe we're going to start seeing him more so they can make this decision on if he's the guy or not?
Oh, they could be, taking a look at him. It could have just, again, been Tim had a little tightness or he was tired. I mean, it was three games in however many days, and maybe they just didn't want to beat up Tim when they probably knew, quite honestly, that they were going to have a very tough game facing a lot of shots. So maybe they just were trying not to beat up Tim for the next game.
Well, what'd you think of Big Bear? Made some good saves.
I think he did fine. I mean, there's nothing I can go from this game and say, oh, it showed well or didn't, because sadly, far too many of the goals that Sporting's given up this year, I can't blame on keepers.
Right.
I don't want to say sadly, because I mean, you're the one that likes to blame shit on keepers, but just sadly, they have given up so many goals that a keeper didn't even have a chance on.
I don't blame keepers. I just push back on when keepers get too much credit.
Or any credit.
Every interaction I've had with John has been great. I like the guy.
Yeah.
I think he's a good keeper. I think maybe his issue, and this is just me, my thought process, is the way he handles difficulties and when things don't go well. Maybe his leadership in the back and his position of his players needs to improve. Hoping we see that.
Made some really good saves, but the passing, there were some inexcusable passes that I saw. The long range passing is not quite there for him. But okay, let's move. Oh yeah, go ahead, Thad.
I was just saying for a lot of players, I won't say they're young at 22, but he's still young as a keeper.
Yeah.
So there's
that's fair.
And they do have Sheway coming up behind him. Mm-hmm. So that's, they gotta see how he's gonna do. He was playing tonight for SKC2 in St. Louis. They lost 2-0, but he made a save on a PK. I know he made a save a couple weeks ago when they do the PK shootouts in MLS Next Pro. So he's kind of doing well in that regard. He made the save on the penalty today, but a St. Louis player got to the rebound and put it in. Sporting didn't react fast enough to stop that.
Can I take the next PK for Sporting?
He did.
Somebody's got to.
Just asking.
He did. As a reference to the media game. Very well taken. Very well taken from him. I wonder if we are, as Kansas City soccer fans, just spoiled by legendary keepers. From Miola to Nielsen to Melia. So I don't know. Maybe for a few years we just have a guy who's pretty good and not legendary. Maybe we're just spoiled by that.
We've had years of guys who were just okay.
Yeah.
I mean, we even had Kevin Hartman, who was a MLS stud, and he was kind of, when he was with us, he was good. There's been some others in there though. Grunebaum, Kronberg.
Keep going.
Grunebaum, oh my lord.
That's he was a good guy. Did like good videos after he retired.
Yeah, we had a couple years of limbo there after Jimmy Nielsen left us.
And oh, Bo Oshoni. I was trying to think of his name. He was good, but nothing spectacular back in the old Wizards days.
Oh, I love Bo.
I love the KC Current, Robert. Big win, 4-1 over the Portland Thorns. Thad, we had talked about them several draws in a row. Maybe dropping some points, not playing as good as they were, but got on track here. Big win over the Portland Thorns.
Yeah, it was. In Portland, they went in, you know, one of the big crowds, one of the places there's always a really good crowd. It was kind of fun, too, because in the last availability before the game, Vlaco actually had thanked the Portland crowd for going back to the, I think it was the 2015 NWSL Cup. Because they were played in neutral sites, and well, they still are, but it was played in a neutral site, and they were Kansas City was going against Seattle, so it was played in Portland. So Portland fans turned out and wore blue for FC Kansas City. So Vlaco, even though he's coached in Seattle and coached against Portland a lot, he thanked the crowd. But no, it was a good win. They started off strong, they did well, and you just can't always contain Sophia Smith. She's too good.
Mm-hmm. Josh, what do you think of the Current at the moment?
I think they're amazing. I wish I could catch more games from them, but the games that I have watched, they are they're so much fun to watch, actually, too. And I think that's what I love. That's what I love so much about the KC Current. I mean, I love the play style. Michelle Cooper's awesome. You know, she's probably my favorite player on the Current right now.
Thad agreed heavily with that one. Strong shake of the head from Thad there.
Yeah, well, she's somebody I didn't think played all that well last year as a rookie. And I thought she kind of played out of position and on the wing. But this year, she's still on the wing, and she is just killing defenders. I mean, she's only got, I think it was one goal and one or two assists. But she is just so dangerous, and like defenders have got to be so scared right now with Timma running on one side, Bia down the middle, and Michelle Cooper on the other.
And has she gotten a national team look yet? Or
not with a senior team? She might have with a youth team.
They should definitely be looking at. I mean, obviously I'm biased, but she's definitely my favorite player. I love watching her play. I love her game, and I love the Current all together. I think it's going to be exciting to see how this season also, you know, plays out. I mean, obviously, I feel strongly about the Current, you know, being able to hoist the trophy at the end. But I'm just excited. I mean, to see a team, to have a team, a Kansas City team who is still undefeated right now, I think is just awesome. So.
To hoist that trophy the first year in their own home, oh, my God. That would be incredible. It's not played at a neutral site, right? We go first place all year long. We'd get to host the final.
I think it is a predetermined site.
I
will say that somebody named Brittany Mahomes said that the final would be here.
Really?
Yeah.
Hey.
And then they quickly shushed her.
I mean, I get, yeah, where else would you want to put the final this year? I mean, it's obviously we would be the place that you would want to go.
It would be the logical place, yeah. So it would just be kind of a, you know, a Cinderella story for that to happen.
What do you mean? When did they shush her? Did she, this was like out loud, or she tweeted it and then deleted it, or what? Where did you see this?
She did it like the opening game.
Oh, really?
somewhere she was talking and they, like, she said
they interviewed her on TV, like, so she might have done it then.
So I didn't hear it live because I don't get to hear those things live, but
Okay, well, that seems to be the only logical way you can end this season with the trophy hoist in our new home.
Well, Orlando is also still undefeated.
Yeah, they are, man.
Same record.
Exact same record. I saw that.
You know, Kansas City has scored more goals. They have a better goal differential. But they have Barbanda. I might be butchering her name. But she's been scoring goals left and right also. So right now it's like Sophia Smith, Banda, and Timwa at the top of the golden boot race.
Barbanda. Hell of a name.
No, so, did we ever get an update on DiBernardo?
Last thing Vlaco said was it was not as bad as people thought it would be. And she's going through the concussion protocol. And I don't remember his exact words, but it was kind of insinuated that the next game or two she should be available.
Good, because she's critical.
Yeah. They have a lot of attackers on the forward line, but DiBernardo is definitely the best in the midfield as far as attacking. Because Davinia is so talented, but I still don't think she pure 10-ish as DiBernardo can be. You have Claire Hutton. I can't ever say it. To me, however she pronounces it is weird to me. But because I just think Hutton, like there's two T's there. But anyway, she's been so good at the six as a rookie, and she's just going to continue to get better. But she's getting more and more into the attack also because she grew up and was a attacking mid when she was young. Which, by the way, there's a short 15-ish minute pod out there with me interviewing her last week. And the next current player that I have on the list to interview is one Michelle Cooper.
Oh, so, look at that. Nice timing.
So the table, good thing you brought her up.
The table is interesting right now. They're undefeated, but at 9-5-0, like you said, Orlando is right there with the exact same record. And then the Washington Spirit is just 1 point behind as well. They're 10-1-3. Gotham is not even that far behind, just 27 points. So undefeated has not been carrying them too far up the table at the moment. Those draws really hurt them in that recent stretch there. But do go check out Keeping Current with Thad Bell and Daniel Sperry. Thad, when is another episode coming out?
We have not set when we will record, but my guess will be tomorrow or Wednesday, because Tuesday I will be busy being at a Copa.
And the Michelle Cooper.
Copa America.
The Michelle Cooper interview coming. Yes, Copa America at Arrowhead coming July 1st versus Uruguay. Are you pumped for that, Thad?
Yeah, but you skipped over the Canada game.
Oh, yeah.
At Children's Mercy Park on Tuesday night.
Tuesday night.
Peru, Canada. Well, actually, it's 5 o'clock, man. I just was looking at the timing, and I'm like, damn, 5 o'clock. I got to be there early.
Tuesday late evening, or late afternoon, I mean.
Yeah.
All right, moving along. What else happened around Major League Soccer? Thad, Kei Kamara. How many goals short is he of Wondolowski now? It's got to be just like maybe 3 or 4.
No, it's like a dozen, I think.
Oh, it is that many? Oh, okay. Well, yeah, then he hit his mark. And his pass, Landon Donovan. Great header. Just such a Kei Kamara goal. It was so vintage of Kei Kamara.
Well, he got 2 goals in 2 games. So, I mean, he's on a roll. And, yeah, it was just a great header, getting up there, being in the right spot. Kai's so good at that.
Love Kei. Really happy for former friend.
Don't know any teams that could, like, that crosses the ball into the box a lot that could use a guy like Kei, do you? Just asking for a friend. Sorry.
Well, we only had 3 crosses the last game anyway, so that doesn't really work at all. Okay, so he passed Landon Donovan.
Yeah, who, is there a reason Landon Donovan's been in the news lately?
Landon is commentating for the Euros on Fox. Poor guy, man. Went viral, understandably so. So he admitted he probably deserved it. I don't know what was going on with his hair. He apparently had a hair treatment of some sort. We didn't really get the full thing. But
a transplant.
So he said he had something like that. Did he actually say a hair transplant? I think he just said a procedure or something like that. Oh, okay. So hair transplant. And then he said he was told it wouldn't show up on camera. I don't know what that even means. Dude, if anyone can see it, it's going to be seen on the camera. But Mike McGee asking him about it and then sending the picture of their tweet of their text conversation was gold. And somehow, I think Landon came out of this on top. Like, Landon looks cool. He laughed at himself. He was like, sure, go ahead. I deserve it. I think Landon scored some points here.
Well, he had to score some points because it wasn't by hairstyle. That's for damn sure.
The internet was mean.
Anybody have Landon's number? I need to call him.
Get that doctor's number.
I got to think that maybe if he looked straight at the camera, it was like not going to show up that much. But when he turned his head to talk to the other person, it just was so blatantly obvious that it was something wrong there.
The angle hurt him. Yeah. I would be a bit upset or salty at the doctor who said that wouldn't show up on TV.
Somebody lied, man.
Not at all salty. I mean, come on.
Whoever did the original thing that's not going to show up, but I mean, who told him this? Was it the hair person? Because, I mean, if you're in front of a camera, somebody's going to come by and, like, apply a little makeup or, you know, dab your forehead to get the sweat off of it. And he's got a lot of forehead to get sweat off of. Maybe not as much now. But anyway, somebody had to come through there and say, oh, yeah, man, no, it looks good. Or, oh, my God, no, dude, you can't go in front of camera that way.
I think he might have.
His partner should have said something.
I think he was
Landon's
deflecting.
Timing? What was his thought there?
I think it was
just before I go on the air.
I think he was passing the buck. He was just deflecting. Yeah, someone told me this wouldn't show up on camera. I don't know that I believe that.
Well, he hasn't always made the best public relations choices in the world. When he was promoting Mexico for World Cup stuff. Yeah, no.
What do you guys think of the Fox coverage so far? They just announced that they got the Euro Women's as well next year. They're just buying all of the soccer, and Josh, no one is happy with the with the coverage. Literally no one seems happy with it.
I don't know. I don't know what it is about the coverage, but I agree. I'm not a huge fan of it. I think the analysis.
It's Alexi.
Yeah. Let's be honest. I think it is Alexi Lawless. His analysis is a bit much. I'll be honest. There's a few people. You know who I would love for. He's at ESPN, but you know, I think if ESPN was doing the coverage, I would really love it. But like. What is his name? Nadim Adur, I think is his name.
I know who you're talking about. He is very good.
He is great in analysis. Yeah. You know, I think he does such a great job covering games. He doesn't cover a lot of games, but he, you know, those are the type of guys I want to see. CBS. Yeah. You know,
it might not be that terrible, but when it's lined up next to that, the CBS Golazo crew, it's just those get Kate Abdo and that whole squad is just so good. That's a pleasure to watch. And yeah, I think it's Alexi Lawless. You've got Schmeichel there. You've got Chiellini there, a German legend, an Italian legend. And even Sturridge is there. I actually think Sturridge has been pretty good. But then it's just some guy with crazy red hair that appeared in a World Cup 30 years ago. And it just doesn't line up. It just doesn't match up there for me.
You can tell that it's not. Yeah, and there's not. You know, with CBS, you know, with Andre and Kate Abdo, Carragher and Micah, they play off of each other really well, and the coverage is very, you know, collaborative and playful, and
they have fun and all like each other, and you can feel that. Yeah.
Just like us.
And you, yes, and you could feel how much Daniel Sturridge hated Alexi Lawless. Couldn't contain. He had no decorum for being on television while listening to one of your fellow pundits give a take. He just head in hands, eyes big. But it's deserved. And honestly, maybe that is, we need more of that. Maybe that will make the Fox coverage more interesting.
Okay. I want to go back to the Landon Donovan thing for just a second. The best thing in that text chain was when he said that, oh, I was told it wouldn't show up on camera. And he said, who told you that? Rafa Marquez?
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. We forgot Mike McGee's Rafa Marquez jab in there. So good.
I cracked up laughing so hard. My wife was like, what's going on down there? Because I was reading it. I was like,
that's why Mike McGee wanted to post that. Not to make Landon look better. Everyone needed to see the Rafa Marquez jab.
It was good.
All right, gentlemen. Josh, thank you very much for joining. Love having you on. Very knowledgeable. Great work for KCSJ. Appreciate you, buddy.
Appreciate it, man.
Thank you. Thank you guys for having me.
Thanks, Josh.
All right, we're going to get out of here. Till next week. Sporting!
Skipper has just been sent off. Some point of strong evolve. Guns off my butt, but tanks got me drinking. My foot, but tanks got me drinking. My foot, but tanks got me drinking. Give me beer or whiskey, wine or gin. Anything to shake this mood I'm in. My foot, but tanks got me drinking. My foot, but got me drinking. My foot, but Tim's got me drinking.